Okay, from last session, we left off with Bella being submerged in the water, and Amarius, trying to save her. A flash flood has hit the group, which has been, it seemed like, as the group, you know, was escaping the kobold, of the kobolds that were pursuing them, and one bad thing after another, but fortunately for the group, the flash flood came and swept the kobolds that were pursuing them away. Unfortunately, Bella and Marius was lost in that flash flood. Now that Nala and Broderick have returned to the party, the waters rise in the swamp as they make their way following this new comrade, this gnome, into her village. So that's what the party is doing right now. So the waters are rising. You can hear the water as they're swelling up, Broderick. We'll start things off with everyone roll initiative.
I had a 15.
Okay. So we'll have Bert go first. Bert, as you continue to chase this gnome that's out in front of you as you're running away from the rising waters, you can hear these of the waters coming around you, and at this moment, there's going to be a small flood in this area. So, you can kind of push through before the waters rise. You make a strength check, or you make an acrobatic check. Which one do? As you're jumping from log to log, from bush to bush, trying to get to the higher ground.
I'm trying to get 100 of. You mean strength or acrobatics? Yeah, acrobatics.
Okay. To 23. So at that moment, you can see a slight debris. Logs and things of that nature. Right, you know, you're just there and you're jumping. You know, you kind of think about it like if you pretend it was lava and there's like stepping stones, you're jumping from one stepping stone to the next. That's how it is. You're jumping from one branch to, you know, one log to one log. You can kind of see. Okay. So next is Garlamon. And Garlamon, what would you like to do? You really don't. If you want to try acrobatics check, you can. But there's bushes there, there's vines, and you know things of that nature. If you want to try to grab onto to propel yourself from this impending doom.
I mean, does that have to be acrobatics, or can I use strength?
Strength.
Yeah, I'll just make a strength check.
Hopping from log to debris. Would you like to do is take Bert's route, or would you like to follow in pursuit of Garlamon?
Garlamon, because if I do acrobatics, I'm going to go swimming.
Okay. So that strength score, you're able to make it, and then we have... I'm going to... Salawish, it's your turn.
I'm going to do an acrobatics check.
Acrobatics.
Okay, we're acrobatics shape. You just click on your sheet, you're not.
The first skill is reads acrobatics. You just click on the name and it rolls.
Okay. Okay, acrobatics. So at that moment, the group continues away into higher ground. At that moment, it's still drenched like a downpour. The rain is heavy. You really can see in front of you. It's slippery. But what it kind of appears in front of you. You see three small stature people in front of you that you didn't see before. They're covered in robes that's made of leaves and twigs and bark of that nature. You've noticed that they have intercepted the first gnome. And, a couple of miles after, the whole thing happened in March. So this is a miles. It's not flooding at this point, but it's the ground under you is giving way to your weight. So you know it's getting damp. And you also notice that there's a small incline. Noticeable, but you can just tell you're getting higher and higher in elevation. The forest is rising between the trees, even starting to get smaller, not as tall as they were on the swamp and the forest. As you continue to make your way, you see these three creatures about the same height as Aloysius and this six gnome as your father. They have their bows drawn, so with a far yet, but you see her motion for the lord their weapons, and they continue on, but now they're picking up their pace. A couple of miles then ensues, and the group finally makes it to a diamond in the rough, as you would say. You make your way to the village. The group is about right here. You can put your people on the map if you just want to. You don't necessarily have to, but it would be easier to keep in contact.
Would everyone or just one token representing the group?
Still be heard of the rain that's pouring, that's pounding this wooden structure. What's odd is that this is a more hilly area, and I have here where I'm pinging, you can kind of see the houses. It's like the houses are built into the hills. See that there are some lanterns lit. You see the gnome as she kind of has a chair there, and she just, you see her, it's like she jumps into the chair to rest, and you see the other three gnomes that's cloaked in this the leaf cloak. You can tell it was kind of camouflage, but what you notice is when you went into this forest place, it was like, if you can imagine, it was hard for you to keep up. It was almost maze like the forest was even as you navigate, but then it was like it was thick, and then you saw a small hole to where like someone who was smaller, Aloysius size, could go in, and you had to navigate. And as you were going in, you would almost get lost, but you could you were keeping a good beat on that, on the person in front of you. Does that make any sense? Like, it was like a small maze, like it almost like this was hidden. And then there's like little tunnels, but it was like in the forest, if that makes any sense. Like it was like a man-made tunnels. And then you, after you appear to the tunnels, you see there's a grand opening of these homes that was built in these hills. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Like a superficial undercity.
Okay. So as you go, the party is in this, what seems to be a public house. And it even says it on the door. And you see the other three camouflage gnomes there standing over this female gnome, kind of with looks of as like, you know, a parent that has that their kid has stayed past curfew. And as they begin to say something, she kind of holds up her hand and says that she doesn't want to hear it. And I will leave the floor for the party members.
Where are we?
She looks at the group and she says, "This is my room. It's more than likely not going to be on any maps that you had ever seen. This is a secret village of gnomes here in the woods of the northern hinterlands."
Do you react badly to seeing a kobold, or just natural?
It's definitely, if it wasn't been with the group, I think they would have attacked on sight. But since you were with the group, and when they went to pull their bows up, and she put her hand down, they followed her. So at this time, they're more worried about her than they are you.
I'm just waving on people I see.
I'm gonna go find a chair and collapse into it as well.
Okay. And you can see that there's a nice fire lit, and like a hearth, and it generally, you know, of course stands up, but it's very nice. You can tell that whoever built this home place took very good consideration. There's actually a bunch of chairs, maybe about 25 chairs in this house, in this place, and then you can see that there's a table or like a podium for about five seats that are nice at the front or in the back of the room. So you can tell this is some type of meeting area. Okay.
So I want to go collapse in a chair too.
Okay. So we have Garlemond and Nalia collapsing in the chair.
Does anyone look like they're wounded?
I think the party in general is wounded, correct? Who looks really wounded?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know where we were last time, but Aloysius is definitely wounded.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty beat up as well.
Then I'm just gonna kinda get a... I'm gonna get a good center area and just hit two channels.
Even the gnomes, they see what you're doing, and they, and the unnamed gnome, the female in front of you, she perks up as well when you do this. Everyone is healed for the 11 damage, or 11 HP.
15.
15, I did too.
No, excuse me. 15?
And I'll try.
Looks tired. She says that it is late. says, my home is not big enough for the five of you, but just know that you'll be safe here in the public hall for the evening. My best advice is to not leave the public hall. Two of these guards will stand guard here on the outside and let know, but come first light in the morning, we'll have a conversation. But just know that you're in good care, that you're safe here.
Thank you. Anything to eat? Or to drink?
She says that she'll have a guard bring something over, bring ale and food.
Nice.
Give her time to make her preparations. So this is all of a sudden. At that time, their group can see Garmine unrolling a damp bedroll and blanket near the fireplace and starting to unravel, unchink, unclasp his gear and put his shield and... Is a sword Garmine or axe? I can't remember.
It's a sword, and he sleeps with the sword and armor on.
Okay, so never mind. He removes a little piece of his armor that wouldn't take a long time to get on in case he was attacked off, that some of that bits of uncomfortable that might be uncomfortable, but primarily his armor stays on as he begins to lay down for the night. And Aloysius is soon to follow. So for Nalia and Broderick, what would you like to do?
I'm gonna go over to Nualia. Are you okay?
Not really.
I don't understand what happened.
I'm not quite sure either.
Those two seem pretty beat up. I don't think we're gonna get any good answers out of them while they're in this condition.
Time goes by, and you see there's two guards there. Two gnomes are there in the public hall with you, with their backs to the door. Kind of like they're watching you to where you don't leave. At that moment, a knock can be heard. It's a brief knock, and it walks in, and you see... one of the other three gnomes that met you in the woods to escort the female gnome to the city. They come in and you can see that they have a basket of berries, a couple of fruit, apples, things of that nature, storm fruits, pears, apricots, with little bits of dried deer jerky. And it's just placed in the table. Nothing said. You see a mug of ale. Nothing that's ever, that's copious in the amount of what it is. It's just maybe if you're lucky, everyone might get one glass of ale, maybe a glass and a half, depending on if somebody tips on their side. And we sat down there near the door, and then that gnome just leaves. Does anyone say anything, or can I assume that we're going to fast forward to the morning?
Don't worry, if you have any water with you, I can make it taste better.
The gnome doesn't say anything to you. and keeps eyeing the group in particular. Eyeing the group.
Yeah, I don't have anything after the last day and a half Garlemon's had. He's ready for a nap.
Yeah, Aloysius is exhausted but comfortable in the presence of other gnomes.
Okay.
I feel the need to take some time and sit and ponder what's happened.
Okay. It seems like it's a blink because the group is so exhausted. Broderick as well. Broderick and Nalia, that trip you took. Nalia, you... Broderick can see it's odd because it seems like Nalia is not the same child that left Sandpoint an hour, 2-3 hours ago. It seems that she has matured and taken on transformation, much like Marius has. Hair, shiny white, almost a goldish tint to it. She's gotten taller, more slimmer, lost some baby fat, as you could say. And even you, Broderick, you feel tougher as well. Your muscles have filled out a little bit. Your tusks have gotten longer. Your beard has thickened up. As it seems that you've matured as well through whatever happened through the dream world or through whatever portal happened to get you to where Marius was at. Shortly after that, you, again, it seemed just like as you close your eyes that you're back up again as the gnome is in front of you. And she says, proper introductions is to be had. She looks worried. She says, just stay here, clean up, get yourself together the best you can and most presentable. A emergency meeting is going to be half in the village. I told my father about what happened at the kobolds and what's going on in the forest and about the tax. And you're safe here, but just know that there's a reason why our village isn't on any map. We take great honor in the privacy and security of our village. And just know that whatever's said in the meeting is not taken personal. So, at that time, you can see a couple of gnomes come in. I'll kind of describe the gnomes to you. And Rosalie, that's the gnome's name. Rosalie, you can see 5 gnomes kind of go up to the 5 seats. One is older, of course. He has gray beard, gray hair, where he's wearing a colorful robe of purple and red and gold. Another one seems to have a monocle. He has a cane, and then the other one has a little a suit of armor on. It seems to be, if you want to roll a religious check, Marius, excuse me. You know that is a Shaylin emblem, and that this is some type of worshiper of Shaylin. And then the other two, one seems to be younger, and then, which is odd, one younger, and then one kind of middle aged. They all sit, make their seats there. Rosalie says to the mice, she says, Meisters, these are the humans, or then the kobold, and she points out, which is the fellow gnome that I met as we were surveying the land to the kobold to see what the recent attacks have been to our hunters in the area. Me and my party tracked down. Give me 1 second. No, let me close your mic real quick.
Okay.
Thank you. So my party tracked down the hunters that were missing a week ago, we found their bodies, or found what was left of them. It seemed they had been half eaten. And we made tracks until we were ambushed by kobolds, which is very odd. You know that we've had a treaty with the green kobolds for many years now, but the green kobolds were mixed in with what seemed to be black-scaled kobolds. I didn't have much time to investigate. Actually, one of the kobolds were green and black-scaled, so multicolored. I've never seen anything like that. Me and my party engaged in combat, and then everything went black. Next thing I know, I wake up, and there's this gnome and another bigger human with red hair near me, and then she points to this dwarf here. Next thing I know, we met another kobold. This one, she points to you, Bert, doesn't attack us, and we go back to their home where they feed us, and then we're attacked by a kobold yet again. We barely made it out past the flash flood, and that's all what happened. At that time, you see all the monsters, you know, they kind of talk amongst themselves and they mumble. And they speak, and one announces himself as the headmeister. His name is Meister Bronstone. Master Bronstone speaks for all the masters and says that. You know the rules, Rosalie, of not bringing outsiders unless it is agreed upon. But with the story that you've told us and about the kobold attacks and how these outsiders helped you, we can make an exception for this time. And then the Meister just looks at the party and says to the party, Rosalie here was not able to get any information about these recent kobold attacks or what's causing them to be more aggressive than past. We normally don't get too much or accept help from outsiders, but do you have any information about the change in the aggressiveness and the nature of the kobolds? And he speaks to the party.
I mean, from what we've seen, it seems that either a group of dragons, perhaps, or a different group of kobolds has been kind of shifting the way they look at the outside world with either stories of aggression or promises of power, or just good old-fashioned threats.
Yeah, and the Meister Bronstone says, we not to overlook the elephant in the room, but we did have two guards inside and two guards outside last night watching, which, you know, we had to take precautions. But you have a kobold with you, and we notice that he is not in chains or a slave.
Well, originally the goal was to, represent the other gnomish town across the river. The goal was to use him to negotiate with the kobold leader, but when we got here, we found that they were not in the mood for talking.
Who is this kobold here with you? Does he know much about what's happening? He is a greenscale, or a greenskin. We have done trade with the greenskins in the past, and they've been not a threat. But now, Rosalie here has given us new information that the greenscales are the ones that attacked our hunters.
And that is the black scale influence. Green scales are not usually aggressive unless you come into their homes. But they are being influenced by black scales and this other langshan with dark clothes.
With dark cloaks. So what are the green scales now?
The main group, I wouldn't know really. I was separated along with some others when the black came. And some others were separated. They said we weren't good enough, so they cut us out. But we were kind of separated from the main group. That's they were with the black ones. They were had more contact with the black ones. I don't know the black ones very much.
Well, it has become an ever-living threat to here at our village. We at Kibosh have taken great pride in being at our own, and we've traded with the Shotowa. What is the Shoti? Is that how they pronounce the Pathfinder natives? Shaoti. How do you pronounce that? Spencer, do you know the pronunciation?
No, I've heard it pronounced multiple different ways.
Shoti. I'm gonna say
Shoti. Shoti sounds good to me.
So we have traded with the Shoti and the Green Scales, and with some, you know, the Sandpoint cities, or Sandpoint Hinterland towns. But it seems that this might be a time to maybe combine forces. Not only is Rosalie's tracking party have now been attacked, so we've had three groups who have ventured outside of our village have been attacked, with Rosalie being the only one. We lost the hunting party. Rosalie's party was decimated, besides her as being a survivor, which I'm grateful for. And then some hunters went out 3 days ago and never came back, and I can now guess that their fate was sealed with a kobold attack. It's going to take some time for the Meisters to have a meeting to decide what we're going to do, but in the meantime, you're safe here. We ask that you be respectful, don't cause any trouble while you're in the village, of course. You will be honored guests here. But I do have one thing that, just for security reasons, don't go to the edge, or don't leave the village. You're not a prisoner here, but we want to speak to you before you leave.
I wouldn't go anywhere without the group.
And they do say, the master said that the kobold needs to be with the group at all time, or with at least one or two of the party members.
And you can bet I won't be alone.
Is there any other intel that you have about the kobolds? I take it that you've made combat with them.
Yeah, they ain't great at it, but they got numbers if nothing else, along with a skilled caster or two.
There was this weird guy in the black dress that he was the one who ordered us to dig under the tunnel, dig under the tower of this guy. It was a woman in the black dress and symbols all over of... let me check what was the detail.
And he has a real baseball dressed in black.
The whole group of her smelled like the swamp, like rotting flesh, and they had strange markers on their clothes of flies and vultures with maggots. It was not that nice.
Does anybody want to roll a religion check to see if that rings a bell?
I'm guessing it's Urgrafoa.
Yeah, just one moment.
Can I roll a gnome check?
For bardic knowledge. Said religion.
She was pale, almost white, with clouds. The whole group smelled like swamp, like rotting flesh. They had strange markers on the clothes, flies and vultures and maggots. And they brought with them this strange device that had two kinds of stones. One of my tribe go near the stone and started to scream in pain before dying.
Spencer, you want to take a guess at what the emblem is?
Um, I don't know the emblems very well, myself.
Well, just guess. You can metagame this, because he gave some details. What do you think this is, what god this is, or what god emblem this is? Before I send you the message, because you rolled well. I'm just seeing if you know.
Flying, well, I mean...
flesh, and pale. Pale blue, pale white.
That doesn't sound like anything of Lamashtu that I know of.
Okay.
Flies white. Zon Kuthon?
Nope, I'm gonna give you this thing because you did well for the emblem.
The flies and the undead and the pestilence.
Oh, psh, I don't know that name.
God carries those elements.
Well, that's what it sounds like the emblem is, so you can tell the group if you choose to.
Well, goddess, not god, carries those elements. A physical excess, disease, and the undead.
That's how it's pronounced.
To me, it's, you know, I didn't, the Andean didn't tell me that, but to me, it is Ugathoa.
Ugathoa? What is with these deities getting involved in all of our business?
Maybe this is just their way of saying they like us. God knows they don't seem to want to leave us alone.
Like, Gorum is very hands-off. So this is weird.
Now, pondering the whys of all of it won't help us none. It's a good question, but for now we should concentrate on solutions for whatever plans we can try and make.
And the gentleman Meister agrees. He says we're going to take a break and start getting the village under lockdown and more guards in the immediate area. He says you're from the gnome city across Nibor.
Yeah, I mean, originally we're from all over the place, but that's where we were before we came over here.
We are very well traveled.
He says, Nibor, how is that mayor doing?
I mean, he seemed all right to me. Seemed like a friendly enough sort. Helping him out is part of the reason we're over here trying to deal with the kobolds, but it didn't end up working out the way we would have liked.
At that moment, the Meister, Bronstone, smirks, and he says, if you do anything for him, make sure that he pays you first.
Well, we got some treasure from him sitting back in town. We didn't bring it with because we didn't think we'd be able to sell it, so at least not yet.
He says more on Nibor later, but he says why are you here in the swamp? He says, I thank you for saving Rosalie here, but why have you ventured so far out into the swamp?
Well, originally we were looking for the kobold village to try and negotiate or fight or duel or just murder the leader and try and set everybody free, yada yada, generic hero crap, you know what I mean. But we've gotten lost a couple times and sidetracked. Nobody really knew where we were going super clearly, and hell, now that we're here in your village, we don't even know how to get back to our boat.
He says, I don't know where your boat's at, but he says we have surveyed the entire forest in the swamp. He says, I don't I personally don't believe, like, my head scout will know about where the entrance of the kobold cave is at. So, I do know where the kobold cave is at and where, you know, maybe the safest route to the cave is. But I'm not sure where your boat is that you took to get here.
Well, and seeing the numbers they've got just sitting out in the woods, I don't even know if our group is... I don't even know if we're equipped to deal with a full-on fight.
He says, we don't have many supplies here, but let us have a day or two. We're going to come up with a strategy. And I want to talk about what you've seen in the forest and what that leader of Nabor has told you about the kobolds, or you know what, more information. Just again, rest up and take your time, relax, and you'll hear from us soon.
Okay. I could help getting more supplies, but I wouldn't want to go far from the group.
Man, he does tell you that Kibosh has some odds and ends up of even the city of Magnamar. Some of their traders have taken trips to cities such as Magnamar, either Kosovo, Riddleport. They don't go very often because it takes such a long time to get there and back, but that even though there's a small community or small village, they're not like, you know, the best supplied on items and things, but they do have some things that you might want to take a look at. So, he says that you can stay here in the meantime with the public hall, and talk amongst yourselves, and that give us a couple of hours, and we'll come back to rehash our conversation.
I don't have any money, so I guess I'll just stay here with the group.
So the group now is still alone. The public hall, after hearing that, on my side, I'm gonna get some things together as far as RP and private messages, and the group can RP or role play for a couple of moments by themselves. I'll be right back.
So we are reading the for the router or what?
Well, it seems like we're just hanging out for now.
Hanging out's one thing I'm good at.
So I'll, Oh, sorry, go ahead.
How did you all meet?
That's a story for a different time. Right now, we've got to handle business. Garlamond, Aloysius, what the hell is going on in this place?
Oh, boy. Well, I knew this was the talk we were going to have either way, so... I'll try and make it easy. From, after our adventures in Sandpoint and headed off to Nabor, like I said to the Meisters, we took a job to help deal with the kobolds out here, and it's been dicey, I won't lie. It's not been easy out here. We've run into a lot of trouble, but during we were staying in a cave with some of the kobolds that had offered to help us, where we found a new gnome friend. We were attacked by a group of kobolds and some kind of giant monster. I don't even know how to describe it. Some kind of like a giant crocodile, but on its back legs, it was ridiculous. While we were escaping the cave, Bella's brother, who had passed out from some illness. Well, we had a hard time getting them out of the cave. And
what happened to Yuri?
Well, he was stuck on a sled and we had to climb about 15 feet of rock walls, and with the enemy closing in on us, we weren't able to get him up there, but as we were leaving, Bella decided that she didn't want him capturing her brother, so she threw some of her explosives down there and tried blowing them all up. We ran through the caves, and I guess the journey and everything that happened, for good reason, obviously, she didn't handle it very well, and when we were attacked at the river, right before you guys got here, she was despondent is probably the only word I could use to describe it. It was hard getting her to move with everybody, and when the rain and the river kicked up, she ended up getting pushed away with it, and with the rising waters coming, I told Marius that, I hate to say it, but the fact is that she's already washed down the river. None of us are very good at swimming, and we have a lot of people we need to worry about saving right now, and we have to save the people we can. We had as you saw, we had a disagreement in that moment, and I guess a lot of things have been weighing on Marius, and he.
That's not what you said in the end. You said that there was nothing stopping him from jumping. Well, why would you say something like that to him?
Well, it's true. If he was going to refuse to come with us, if jumping was what he wanted, I can't stop him. I can't make him come with us. In the end, it had to be his choice. And he made his choice. We didn't have time to stand around. We didn't have time to talk about it. We had to move. It is what it is. It's not pretty, and it's not nice, and nobody likes it, but the facts are the facts.
It could have been explained to him better.
Well, I was under a little bit of pressure. I'm sure you'd understand. Half dead, traveling for days on end, fighting constantly, trying to get people across a shitty little log with a rope bridge held between me and Gene. I didn't exactly have time to sit down and have a fireside chat with him.
We've just lost so much. We can't take another hit like this.
Yeah, I know. The problem is that now that we're here, far away from our way home, hell, I'm not really sure what we're gonna do at this point.
I kinda like it here.
Well, that doesn't surprise me too much. It must be like being at home for you.
It's not bad. All the furniture is the right size.
What is your home like?
Yeah, Robert, what is your home like?
I'm something of a wanderer. I could get used to these creature comforts, though. Kind of put Aloysius's puts his feet up.
As the conversation ensues, you can hear Nolly in the back finish eating a little bit. Nolly, do you have anything you want to say?
Good gonna say he didn't have to jump. Why did you say that?
I didn't feel like arguing with him then. I've never had kids. I didn't have time to think about it. It was do or die. It's what came to me. I've been doing this for a long time, and you just don't always have time to worry about everyone's feelings. Sometimes you just gotta move. I didn't think he'd do it.
Maybe he wanted to go with Ghost Ray.
I still can't believe he's gone. Maybe he'll come back.
Think he survived the flood?
As Burke asked the question, do you think he survived that the jump? The Mitres have coming back, and they see how hurt the party is. Bronstone says, for your group. Again, you're more than welcome to stay here. He's like, I've talked to the other Mitres, and Rosalie is one of our strongest warriors besides the Mitres here, but we can't leave the village in case an attack happens. And if Rosalie's team of scouts and trackers were not able to survive just a small ambush of the kobolds, we fear what power they've gained in this little time. And if they have gained powers at such a fast rate, we fear what might can happen if a week or even 2 week passes. We don't have much to offer, but the Mitres, we've talked it over, and we can take one or two of you and maybe train you for a day or two, maybe three, at tracking in the woods, and maybe doing some combat here. Maybe talk to some of our warriors about some of the tactics of the kobolds and how they move and how they act in a pack, or their combat tactics. We don't have much equipment, like I say, and he says that what we sometimes do, for the show team or travelers that come into the town, we let them buy or let them borrow supplies on credit. If you do go to the Kobold Cave, we can only fathom that whoever controls the kobolds, they're going to have weapons and armor or valuables there. We can let you borrow a certain amount of items of equipment from our town, and if they're damaged or broken or lost, you'll have to pay a fee plus interest. But if you go to the Kobold Cave and you find valuables or treasures, you can just bring a part of that back to us and pay it off. So think of it kind of as like credit. Or in real world terms, borrowing on what you have that's able to be liquidated. Does that make sense?
Yes. Maybe improving my shield or buying some item. Some potion might be useful. Yes.
Don't get me wrong, I appreciate your hospitality and all of this, but if we're dealing with the kobolds that even you guys have admitted are a huge problem for your society, have killed off many of your people, and in the end, I have to say, if we're gonna go deal with them, and I'm sorry, but we need help. We need bodies. We don't need debts. Like, I get it. You can't just throw away the value, but like, we can't do this. We can't just do this on our own, and we certainly can't just do it for free. We can't go into debt doing this. We need some help. Send some guards. Give us some equipment. Don't sell it to us.
The equipment will be much, much more useful if someone is wielding it.
True. He says we're only a town of, we were a town of 34, but now that we've lost Rosalie's other three members, and we've lost the two hunters, and then we lost four hunters, you can see that our numbers have changed just in the last week. And those were good fighting gnomes. He says, I'm sure that we could be able to get a volunteer or two. We should be able to get a volunteer or so to come and help.
We don't need people on the front line. If you have some folks who are good with bows or know some basic magic, just anything will help at this point. But they got numbers on us. They know the lay of the land better than us. We're in over our head. We're down people. We're down on equipment.
Even if they're half as good with a bow as I am.
Okay. He tells you, I will look and see what we have. He says most of the inhabitants of the village are farmers, good farmers, good fishermen, and good hunters and trackers. And then, of course, you saw the Rosalie's, the guards that have escorted Rosalie here. Maester Glittersky would be one of the arcane, but I'm worried that if we was to send him, he would be one of the four or five maesters gone from the city, and we definitely need him if an attack were to happen.
I mean, even if just a couple of your hunters joined us, they know the woods better than us, and I'm sure they're good enough with a bow that they could at least provide some cover. I don't want to put any people directly in danger, but we need somebody to help. We need some help filling out the gaps here, because I don't know how many kobolds there are, but I imagine there's a lot more than there are of us.
Can we go back to the river?
Which river do you mean? Oh, no, never mind. I just realized you weren't here for the initial river. Any particular reason you want to go back?
I want to look for Marius.
I mean, I'm certainly open to helping you, but. And I do apologize for this. I do feel it might have to wait given our current circumstances.
And what circumstances are those?
It's all rest of it. Rest of the night.
The impending threat of kobold attack on this village?
Wasn't that where you encountered some kobolds, was back at that river?
Yeah, and they got washed away into the swamp. Or killed and washed away into the swamp. We've encountered kobolds every 30 feet in this place, Broderick. You don't understand. It's been never ending since we got here. They're everywhere.
But I'm just meaning while we look for Marius, others can potentially try to track where they came from, how they were able to follow you to that river. That could provide an opening.
The maester speaks up and says, well, The scouts have kind of been back to the area, but they've really tread with caution. They're only a couple of miles from here, which it really worries me. There still is like a standing pool of water there. It will take a couple of days for the water to go down to even to begin to trap back into the kobold settlement. So I know that we have a buffer of at least 3 or 4 days, maybe 5, before the waters go down enough to where if there is an immediate attack, that we do have some days and time to plan and prepare.
So we have a few days to look for Marius. And for Bella.
He just said the whole area is still covered in water, Broderick.
That doesn't mean that they couldn't have got up on shore somehow.
I'm not going back, Broderick.
I don't know how you expect we're going to be able to look for him, Broderick. If that place is like a lake, we don't even have a boat. They could be, even if they are alive, they could be miles downstream. It's a gigantic area, Broderick.
The Maester listened to you, and he says, "Who are these two people that you mentioned?" He looks at you, Broderick. And he addresses you as Broderick. I'm going to assume that's your name.
If yes.
Maybe we could at least find the bodies. And give them a proper rest.
He says that we could make a raft or give you a canoe. I mean, it would be like more like portaging at this point. If you did want to go back, I fear that there could be more kobolds but I don't know. You said the Garlemon said that they washed away, so. You will have some time if you do want to go and look for your comrades. I would do the same. I sent people out here look for Rosalie, so I could understand you wanting to find a fallen comrade and have peace with them, no matter if you find them living or in another life.
Aloysius, you would soon abandon a friend? We have time.
We almost died out there.
We've almost died multiple times. That's part of it.
Broderick, if you want to go, I won't stop you. I won't even try to convince you out of it. I understand why you want to go. I get it. I do. I've lost my fair share of friends in the world. But we have things we need to do after this. We have things we need to prepare for. I need to talk to the people in town. I need to find out if we have volunteers, if we can obtain equipment. I have things I have to do here, and I have things that we have to accomplish. If you want to go find Marius, body, alive, dead, whatever, I won't stop you. And if we have time after this, I'm happy to help you. But right now, there are things we got to get done. It's just what it is.
Yeah, Ghost Ray is all over the swamp right now. You can't just get in there and expect not to go swimming.
I'm going to say to one of the maesters, would some of the scouts be able to join Nualia and I as we attend this search?
He says I could give you the one that I was going to have escort you to the kobold cave. He knows the area the best. He would know where there would be a fort, maybe on the river. He might want to know. But if any idle rumor of combat, anything looks that it could be dire, I'm gonna have him come back because he is our best. His name is Rowan. Rowan Lightfoot.
Nualia, how do you feel?
I want to go and look for Marius, but I can see that could be dangerous with the water still risen.
If he has survived somehow, perhaps he'll be able to keep himself safe. He is very formidable.
I would like to go look for him.
Okay. So who's wanting to go look? Nualia, Rowan, and then Roderick, correct?
Yep.
Okay. So that would be that group. What would Garlemagne and Aloysius like to do? Jean at the moment is sleeping.
I'm just gonna enjoy being around other gnomes and kind of hang out and visit and talk about gnome stuff.
Okay.
I'm gonna, if since we have a couple of days anyways, I'm gonna work on retraining that feat. I've been looking to retrain and work on 5 days.
And how much time?
Five days.
How much money?
Let's see. It's 250 gold, which I can. I do.
Okay, now we can keep that in mind. So that means if you do this, that means before you can do anything, you go anywhere, it's gonna be 5 days before the group can do it.
Well, they said it sounds like it'll be about 5 days, anyways.
Yeah, 35, so you know.
And Anytime I'm not spending training, I want to talk to the local hunters and trackers and people of that sort, figure out who might be willing to go with us and who's trained to do so.
Okay. Ray for free. New language, hit points, feet. A feat is 5 days. A feat takes 5 days for a character who has the feat you want. Oh, you have to have somebody who has the feat. You may change one feat to another, retrain. A feat takes 5 days with a character who has the feat you want. The old feat can't be one you use as a prerequisite for a feat. Class feature, archetype, or chase class. And if the old feat is a bonus feat granted by a class feature, you must replace it with a feature that you can choose using the class feature. What feat do you have?
Well, if it's got to be one that somebody needs, that somebody already knows, I'm going to have to wait till we go to Magdemar. Because there is not a chance in hell anyone on this continent outside of Magdemar knows it.
What feat is it?
The second stage of the Bulwark style of fighting.
Oh, okay. Well, I cannot complain with that. You're right.
Yeah, there is not a chance I can learn it.
Okay. My apologies for that.
Fuck.
We know the rules for that. Okay. Now, that's what Grandma's are going to do. So investigate it work. Roger and
Grogamon,
Bert, what would you like to do?
Yeah, I'm indecisive if I were to stay in the town to make people to know the people and they know me, or to go on adventure with the other ones. Yeah, both are interesting options.
Let me know, because we're about to do something.
Well, since it will be time to take some time to make friends with the gnomes and everything, I think it would be better to go with the adventuring party.
Okay.
But we should rest first.
Okay. So when you want to do this searching, looking for the other party members?
At least one night. To recover spells and stuff.
So what you want to do? You're going to sleep?
New Alia, how do you feel?
I think we should rest first.
Okay. So that is one more day added to the...
At least if we are down hit points or spells.
So everyone get your level. What level are y'all? 5 now? Everyone get 5 HP back?
That will be much more useful.
I will say this, like, if we're going to go the day, and there's not going to be anything right before bed, I would essentially hit my spell slots and my 4 channel energies to pretty much bring everyone up to full or within a single night's rest of full.
Okay, that's fair.
Would there be a way we could leave during the night, or would that be worse?
Do you have dark vision?
I believe
so. I think so.
I can see in the shadow, not in total darkness. And if it's full moon night, I could see some things, but...
Actually, okay, I'm gonna get back to character voice, despite the fact it's killing my throat. Thank you, sinuses.
The kobold, actually points out something great. If we can see in the night, they can't. They have to have some sort of light. We may be able to move better than they can.
But usual kobolds do see in night. Actually, they don't see that well in the daylight. So, if you're hunting kobolds, it's a good thing to do it in daylight.
Never mind, we'll go with that.
I'm the one who doesn't see in dark and full darkness.
Okay.
You see Burke like and moving and like swinging his leg and maybe ashamed of not being able to see in darkness.
That's actually funny. Burke's mad he can't see in dark.
No, Burke doesn't have dark vision.
Okay, so we're gonna rest, and did you use your channels, or did you just use them all up?
I would pretty much use them all up. I mean, I don't know technically where everyone is, but I, between spell slots and channels, I have more than enough to get everyone a full. I'm gonna use Aloysius' picture. Burke, are you coming too?
I'm going to the river, right?
Are you going to the river?
Yes. Yeah, let's go. I can help you guys. I can help you find your parents in the forest.
Okay. Here we go. So, it definitely is. Here we go. make your way back to the swamp, the water's high. And you have a canoe, I'm going to assume that you know, there's parts where you have to portage, and do you have a canoe? Broderick, and you're tired just from carrying the canoe because it's so heavy. As you pick it up and you have Nalia help, and then you put it back in the water, you paddle some more downstream, then you hit a little spot of land, and then as you hit the water again, you know, you understand what I'm getting for. You do it, you get out of the water, you do it again. Anyways, when you finally make it back to the river, but all this is, you know, only thing that is like this right here. And then, let me see if I can. It's like here, bits of here, you can see bits of here, and bits of here where I'm pinging at, if you could see here.
Would we need to roll anything to check for any sort of tracks?
Well, this is underwater.
Well, you said like some of it, like around the shore. Well, I mean, that's what the canoe is for, is to, you know, get around the water, kind of walk around the shore, see if there's anything that looks like human and or rat folk footprints.
Is it perception or survival? Is it both that you can use to check for traps?
Notice that new stuff is perception, but to follow tracks is survival.
There we go. So yes, you three can make a perception check. Damn.
Said perception?
His way. You notice in this area, Bert. You notice you don't know if it's. It looks like something slid up or slid down. You don't know if that's a croc or if it's another boat. But you can definitely see where something looks like it slid into the water. This point, at that point right here, where that little ball's at. Right here. Okay. And the other, I'm gonna use Aloysius, the other gnome. When Bert makes that comment, the gnome speaks up and says, it does like something slid up into the water, sort of slid out. And it does look wide. It looks large. And he looks at you, Broderick, since you were the person who wanted to go, you and Walia. He looks at you as in what to do next.
Is there a way I could sneak up closer and get a better look?
Sneaking up, I'm going to assume that you all four are on this canoe now. Once you pass this, you are on the canoe. Then everybody's gonna have to be on it, or unless you say you're not on it.
Okay. So there's no solid ground or anything?
This, what you're on is a solid ground, and this is solid ground, and then down here, solid ground.
So something like this?
Yes. No, that's not. This.
Rowan, you're the scout. You know these woods, obviously, a lot better than us. Do you think whatever that thing is over there, is it a danger to us?
He says it's, he says I'm not that far to go look. I would have to go look at the twigs and stuff, but it seems that either someone has a canoe and it's, or a boat and sliding up and in this area, what is going to be a crocodile. But I've never seen a kobold in a canoe.
Nualia, do you want to go take a look there? Or, since we have this lead, do you think maybe we're able to wait until the waters go down?
How dangerous are the crocodiles? I'm asking Rowan.
He says, I think, one, if you're the group that helped Rosalie's party survive, I'm sure that the crocodile is a threat, but crocodile in water is a threat. A crocodile in the water can kill each and every one of us. On land, I'm not worried. But it's in this disputed, dark water is what scares me.
Nualia, I can't lose you too.
I think we should wait to...
Could help illuminate the water a bit and give us some advantage to see it. I mean, casting dancing lights in the water. Keep it close to the canoe.
Okay. I mean, you still bring some lights over here, but it is more in the day, and even though this is a more of a shaded area in the swamp, nothing but dancing light happens.
I mean, below the water, so illuminate below the water.
You definitely will illuminate a little bit of the water, but this is high. We're talking about 40 feet of dark, fetid, swampy, brackish water with debris. Okay.
Well, if it doesn't work, I'll just dismiss them on that.
Okay. So Rowan looks at you, he says, and he points at you, Burke, and says, I didn't see anything with that. Did you see anything?
I mean, the lights beneath the water?
Yeah, he's asking, he said, I didn't see anything.
He means to the prince, or to the, what he means?
He's speaking to you, saying that when you did the lights, he didn't see anything. Did you see anything?
No, nothing. The water doesn't let see anything. Too murky, you see.
He looks over you at Broderick and Nualia, not saying your name. He said, so, Meister asked me to bring you out here to look for fallen comrades. He says, it seems that we can go further down, but what do you two want to do? Do you want to continue to search in this area? Do you want to head back?
Go ahead, Nualia.
So my character is wise but not intelligent, so I think I want to use stealth and get a little bit closer.
That's probably fine.
But does anyone have a rope?
Yeah.
Can I hold one end of the rope tied to a star knife and the have the other people hold the other end of the rope?
How is the current DM?
It's stagnant.
Okay.
It's stagnant. It wouldn't take much to swim in it. It's like a swamp, you know, it's just high. It's not as stilty as like the Okefenokee, if you know what that is, but it's still pretty murky. So what would you like to do with a star knife? Would you like to throw something over there? Just to create some type of splash or something?
I was thinking more of a backup in case I get caught in the swamp.
Create a grappling hook?
But throwing something over there would probably be smart.
Well, I'm not sure.
All right, I'll take out my rope and grappling hook,
okay. And
just kind of, and I'll throw it in the water a couple times over there to kind of disturb the water a little bit to see if there's anything going on before we try to get over there on the raft. And if we take the raft, what we'll do is we will kind of tie the rope off over here and get ourselves over there, and if anything seems fishy, no pun intended, wow, that was a good one there, Spencer, if anything seems a little bit off, I will pretty much pull that rope like crazy to help get the raft back to shore fast.
Okay.
Good plan. So you need more rope and yours is okay.
Where's the ruler thing?
It's 50 feet of rope, usually. I have a pack. So if you have one, we can have...
I got 50-foot rope.
And it's 45 to the other side, plus a bit for tiny, so I guess it should be okay.
And yeah, so first... First disturbing the water, and then trying to actually get the rope set up between.
Okay. So you're grappling that area? You're just grappling that area over there?
First just having it splash in the water, and then just hand retrieve it a few times.
What about putting meat on the hook? Like some rations or something.
Okay, so we got.
I'd rather not get pulled in the water.
So we got Spencer. Okay. So Spencer throws the grappling hook.
We shouldn't add meat on that. We don't want to attack.
And you hear a lot of splash in the water.
Okay.
All right, and I just, like I said, just do it a few times to see if anything pokes its head up in the water. If we start to see any sort of current or movement, since you said that it's pretty stagnant, that there's nothing going, looking for any outside of the circular waves that would happen if there were to be any movements in the water.
At this time, Spencer... After the many splashes you've made, you don't get a sense that anything is there before you, excuse me, you don't see anything move. You just keep riddling the grappling hook in, and you throw, you hear splash. You reel it in, you throw, you hear splash. You do this for a couple more times, you reel it in for a final time. You wait for the ripples to dissipate, and the water goes back to me. The calm field that it is. And as you wait, looking to see if anything's noticed this impact that you made disturbing the stagnant waters. It's still silent. And only thing you can hear is the drips of water dripping from the trees above you.
Alright, New Walia. I'm gonna get the grappling hook and I'm gonna chuck it to that other shore. That way, her and I can go venture over there.
Okay. So you.
And essentially. Sorry. And yeah, so it to get it hooked, kind of secure on something, pull us over on the raft like. Almost like a miniature ferry,
mm-hmm.
and then we investigate, and then go back.
Okay, so start doing that. I'll put you and Nolly together.
We're in the raft, right?
Mm-hmm. You don't? Do you want to be in the raft?
Am I supposed to go in the raft too?
It's up to you. It holds four. A long boat, a long canoe.
We're going to the other side, so I'm not gonna stay alone in here.
Okay. Rowan's.
Alright, come on.
Rowan's saying he's gonna stay here. When he gets out of his boat. Okay. So, I think it's about you. You make it over there. This is the area here that you see. It's wrong. This looks like it right here. A little bit, looks like the debris. You can kind of see where something slid into the water here.
Alright, New Walia. What do you want to look for?
What prints are we looking for again?
Look for... I think I might cast Detect Evil, just... I don't know if that makes sense, but just be sure.
I'm gonna change some things up. Nualia, What do you do in this area? You do detect evil, but it's a lingering aura. You know that something evil once stood in this very same spot that you're standing in. You don't know if it was a couple of days ago, a couple of hours ago, or even a couple of minutes ago. But you know that once you stand, something with a strong lingering aura of evil stood where you stood. Burke, with your survival check, as you know, Burke, Nalia, can I assume that you're going to tell the party that? Or are you keeping that private? Is that private information, Nalia? Is that public information?
I'm going to tell the party that.
Okay. Well, as you tell the group, Burke is going to take his knee and put it to the ground and start looking at any tracks or any sign of movement leading from this slide-in spot there marked on the map. And as Burke looks around, he notices prints. He notices the prints was made with large prints of that. It looked to be like some type of reptilian beast. Whether it be a crocodile or some type of lizard that is quadruped. Some type of, looks like some type of lizard or reptilian beast.
I was passing here, you said?
Mm-hmm. And the prints look like this.
Ooh.
They're zigzag.
Like he's walking.
Nualia, we need to get back to the other side. If what you said is true, we're in a lot of danger.
Yeah, I agree.
Come on, Burke.
Let's go. Have to be prepared.
DM, did you say this was a swampy-like area? Okay.
I need to get my sword. You hear Broderick say, as going back across.
I assume he's starting to jump in the raft. I'll just jump on the raft to go with him.
Okay. And Rowan has his bow out, kind of has an arrow nook still kind of covering you from as you pass the other side of the river. He lets it go down, doesn't dry fire. He slowly lets it so it doesn't dry fire. And he says, "Did you two get what you came to look for?"
No, but there's something evil here. We need to get out.
And the group makes their way back to Kibosh. kind of finds time to talk to the group. He says that was a very large sliding area. If that was made by a crocodile, it would have to be twice the width of our canoes.
Maybe the big lizard we found earlier?
Yes, the one we found earlier.
Rowan, I have a question. Do you know of dragons in the area?
There's rumors of a dragon hundreds of years ago before we really settled in this area, but what scale would you think it would be?
I don't know, I'm just, between the way those tracks looked, that kind of a slide in, I'm worried that it might have been more of like a tail. I've been only a couple weeks ago we came across a black dragon, Nualia and I did. Yeah, sorry Nualia, this is probably something you should know. We came across a black dragon. It was, I don't think it would have been to this scale. But for the Lamashtu. Yeah.
How was it? Tell me.
It was a black dragon. It called on the mother of monsters. And I've been dealing with that for a couple weeks now. Lamashtu seems to be on the move. And call me paranoid, but I think there are dragons that like to be in the water.
Rowan tells you, he says we found, as of our hunting party, which made us venture out more, we have found deer at the bottom, as we would be fishing in the swamp. We have found deer and crocodiles. And more in lakes and ponds recently. We didn't know what would be causing this, but we didn't know if it was some type of plague or disease that was affecting them, but it seems that we have been finding a lot more wildlife floating in the swamp waters. I don't know if that's any connection, but I felt led to tell you that. The hunting party found four deer floating in the middle of the swamp.
Had they been eaten at all, or?
No. They've just had been swollen and had been festering, and it's like they had been, they're just soaked in the swampy water.
All I know is there's been a lot of different deities, and they're being thrown about. I don't know if Urgathoa and Lamashtu have anything in common. Burke, do kobolds deal anything with dragons?
Well, if a kobold sees a dragon, you can bet he will worship it. Do everything he says.
I don't know, I've just got a... Just got a bad feeling. We also encountered a Hydra once. But this seems... maybe bigger. I don't know, can Hydras get bigger?
He's kind of now talking to himself a little bit.
There was something evil there, in the swamp. And we don't know what it was.
The swamp, they don't even...
There was something that had been there that was evil.
She's like, I'll take this to the Meister. Storm at once and definitely let him know. This new discovery just enforces that something needs to be done. Again, we have a couple of days, so even myself, I'm gonna begin to sharpen arrows and craft bows for defense of the town, and we're gonna make traps around the town and maybe lock down the tunnels in case there is an attack and start going over evacuation and defense position and maneuvers within the town. Our homes are pretty much inside solid hills, which we'll be able to put up some type of defense. But we're just worried that if the kobolds who come this way, they outnumber us and swarm us. So if we can just put a dent in their fortunes, if there were an attack, that's going to be the goal. So, Rosalie, would that news make her way? You can see her head towards the Master of Bronstone's home. What is the party doing now that Broderick and Wally had their time? I guess Carlona Aloysius, I guess I can assume the Aloysius is still talking amongst the gnolls.
Yeah, for sure.
That you want to ask the gnolls in particular that you've thought about, or is there anything you want to look forward to shop?
I just want to see if they know any more about the kobolds that maybe we haven't heard from, you know, the maesters yet. Something about maybe the locals would know.
You have a local check. The knowledge local. I might see if I can find anything, even though I would argue that we else, you know, you're on the woods. Well, unfortunately, I wish you didn't pick anything up that was not already known to the party. A lot of the same old, the kobolds, the green kobolds are friendly. For the most part, as long as they do not intrude on their lands, that the group actually, you know, anyway, that's it.
Okay, that's what I'm gonna do then.
Gullibar, would you like to do anything before I bring it back to a party collective?
Yeah, I mean, I already told you my plans and the main goal I had, I'm not even gonna be able to do till we get Magnemar, so yeah, there's not really anything else for me.
Okay, so as a collective, I could assume that the party is continuing to make their home base to Public Hall, as seen on the map. Rosalie will enter into Public Hall, and she says we do have 5 days, I believe, 3 to 5 days. We're going to continue to go back and monitor the water recession. And once the water recedes, we might talk about scouting the Kobold Cave and seeing what their forces look like to see if they have a force that's kind of stationed outside the camp. And if not, or if so, if it is too much, we might have to then make a couple of days' journey to your boat. I'm not sure where your boat's at, but I can guess that it's on the lake, on the other side of the board.
Yeah.
What is Burke Redcoat? He is performing, he's singing a song, and Roderick is doing drums.
Yeah, with Oratory is telling us.
So, Burke and Broderick can be seen at the amphitheater.
Getting some slam poetry like story time.
Is there anything that Broderick or Burke would like to say? Is there anything that Burke would like to say with the accompaniment of Broderick's drums behind him?
My kids are asleep, or I bust out my cajon.
Mostly tell about times when he will go gathering herbs and fruits with Tick Tick, and things he found in the way. That we had with his shaman friend.
Do I have any? But anyways, you get the point. So Broderick and Burke over there, B&B, over there, causing the fuss at the amphitheater. At that time, it is an amphitheater, so it can be heard. You do see a crowd of gnomes pick up outside the amphitheater. Can I assume that the party might be led to this noise as well?
Yep.
So, Gollumar, if you and Lavin walk over here as well, you can see little known kids, women and children, and some of the workers, such as the farmers, the ones that work at the granary, sheepers, all gathered around, listening to Broderick and Burke's song of story about picking herbs and skipping stones and hanging out with his shaman friends. So pretty much this is the equivalent of D&D crunchy music. this is what Burke and Broderick are going on. And it seems that the gnomes are in a more of a dour mood, but upon seeing the performance, you see that a couple of them are starting to smile, a couple of gnomes are asking them their father's head so they can see more, see better. And it seems that the morale with this song and dance put on by a kobold and a half orc has sparked and gave a fresh of life into this community.
After we're done, I'll say to Burke, well, maybe that can help you earn a little bit of a reputation with these gnomes to where they'll be a little bit more trusting of you.
And you can hear the sound of the crowd as they are pleased with the performance. As they cheer you on. After that, the crowd disperses. The Meister shakes your hand, Roderick, as well as yours, Bert. And I tell you to thank you, since, you know, and what's happening in these last couple of days, it is beneficial to the village itself to relax, and even though this is serious times, to not forget the importance of life and the fellowship in each other. He says, you know, since you two are keen with instruments, us gnomes, we love to dance and song, and as you can see, even though the village is small, you notice that we built an amphitheater, an amphitheater here. He says, we actually have someone who is quite versed in the performing arts that it may behoove you to talk to.
That'll be great. I like hearing stories. I can tell them someplace else. One day I'll perform in a big theater with a lot of people. We'll see.
So, the amphitheater, you can know, is built so that even the people in the farthest row back from the stage can hear as well up to the closest. The acoustics are really good, that you really don't even need to raise your voice to be heard, and that even the softest note of Broderick's drum or the snap of a finger can be heard even to the most remote listener. So you can tell that this amphitheater was made with very good craftsmanship. After your performance, Broderick and Bert. The Meister tells you, he says, feel free to use the amphitheater anytime, as long as you know it's not after hours. He says, for the performance, you know, he says, let me check my personal storage. Let me see if I can't give the two of you something as a reward for cheering up our town. I'm not sure how helpful it will be in the coming fight or battle of the kobolds, but I'm sure it's best left with you than just sitting in, you know, the cabinets at my house.
Surely, surely.
So that is Burke and Project Nalia. As you come up to the party and see the gnomes, like I said, the children dancing and, you know, clapping their hands, and Burke and Broderick playing their instruments, what would you like to do as you walk upon their performance? Well, you're kind of hitting the end of it. The end. You're kind of at the end of the performance.
Okay, I just watch.
Okay. So, let me see. At that time, as you're watching the performance or at the end of it, one of the Meisters, Wally, that you remember seeing with the Shaylin, I think that's how you pronounce that.
Hey, it's Shaylin, it's okay.
Shaylin.
The goddess of arts, yeah, and poetry and beauty.
Shaylin, the one that you remember, do you remember having the emblem of Shaylin, the bird with the multicolored feather?
Hmm?
She walks up to you, Molly, and kind of, she's shorter than you, so she kind of puts her hand, you know, as like a, more of a, like a mother to daughter type of, grasp, and she touches, like, you know, your arm or whatnot, and since you're just watching, not really saying anything, she asks you, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling a little bit despondent, but I have an idea that maybe might help. And I was wondering if I could have a canvas to paint on.
At the first moment of you asking about a canvas, she smiles with delight and says, "Sure, I have. Are you an avid painter yourself?"
Yes.
She says, "Sure." She walks over and says, "Well, I don't have anything with me, but I have a small studio at my place. We're gonna call them bungalows. We're gonna say gnomes live in bungalows. How about that? At my bungalow, and I have hundreds of different colors of paints, different textures, different paints, different styles of paints that I would be more than welcome to share with you."
Okay, I would really like that.
Sure. So at that time, it's here. She ushers you there.
Okay.
So is there anything in particular that you, she brings over and she tells you that it wasn't just, luck that brought you here. It was fate. And she gives you a canvas here and she gives you a brush, of course, and there's a couple of different paints. And you can see that when you walk into her home is covered in paints and murals. She's actually painted murals on her wall, and you can see something very odd. You see this small gnome there, you assume that she's fighting. She's throwing spells or whatnot, but then you see something. I'm not sure if you would notice. Do you have religion, Wally, or not?
I was just checking that a little while ago, and I don't think I do.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna send you the picture of the painting you see. Let me go, Molly. This is what you see. You can get a chance. You can describe it to the party or not. There we go. And as you look at this picture, Nalia, she tells you, she says, "Child, I don't think it's just luck that's brought you here. You have more that's at stake, or you have more that's at stake here, that this is fate. And that your life, ironically enough, could be a representation of this picture here."
Okay, I describe it to the party. It's this tall figure. Well, there's two people, and one is this really dark, almost diseased or kind of looking person with spikes coming out of their head, and they're dressed in red. And then there is another person attacking them with, who is dressed in white and has long flowy hair, and one half of the picture is kind of idyllic, and there's a building and blue clouds, and then the other half is dark and fiery, and there are bats flying through the air. It's very definitely a conflict between good and evil.
Yeah, I know that picture.
And she is speaking to you, and I knew you described that to the party, which you, I will assume that you described it after the meeting. But she says, after she says that to you, what do you say?
I look at it and say that it's beautiful but scary at the same time, and I wonder what it means.
She says that that is for you to decide. She says, "I am just here. We were you were brought to this small village of Kibosh for a reason. And maybe I don't know what's happened to you in your past life, or why your eyes shine with gold, or why you just illuminate this presence of radiant positive energy around you, that even though I see your aura, you mask it with that despondent, you know, attitude, that dire attitude of yours. And just know that the pieces of your adventure is going to unfold, and this picture is the first step to that.
Okay.
So at that moment, Nualia will start to paint, and I will give Nualia time until the next session to think about what she would like to paint in detail. And even though it was a heavy role play, we have played for a little bit, 2 hours, and I'm going to call the session quits for this evening and end the session.
Okay.
And we will play next time. So for those who are viewing, thank you for the continued support, and we'll be back at it in 2 weeks.
I post the image I found.